In this video, I'm going to give you a guided tour of the awesome engine that can make this helicopter lift its own weight in fuel, cargo, and passengers. So stick around. Hi, I'm Rick James from The Pilot Teacher, and today I'm going to give you a guided tour of the Arriel 1D1 engine that's on this B2 Astar, and it's going to be awesome. So let's go and have a look. So this is the Arriel 1D1 engine from Turbo Mecha, and it's on the B2 Astar from Eurocopter, and it is an awesome engine. Generates around about 732 shaft horsepower when I'm at full power, and then it drinks about 180 liters of jet fuel every hour. So a little bit thirsty, but all gas turbine engines are. This one is a turbo shaft engine, and I'm going to explain what the difference is between a turbo shaft and like a regular jet engine that most of you see sticking on the end of the plane wing when you're going on vacation. This engine is very, very powerful. It's very efficient, very clean, as you can see. It's very easy to see when I'm doing an inspection on it. And the most important thing about it is it's very, very reliable. These engines are bulletproof. The B2 Astar is one of the most popular helicopters in the world as a working machine, especially. And these Turbo Mecha engines are just bulletproof. Very, very good engines. So this engine allows this aircraft to lift pretty much its own weight in cargo. So the empty weight of this B2 is about 2,800 pounds, and with an external load, I can lift with a max gross weight of 5,512 pounds. So it's about 2,700 pounds in fuel, cargo, and passengers that this engine can allow this aircraft to lift, which is insane. It's awesome. Power in this thing, I very rarely have to worry about power unless I'm lifting something really heavy on an external load. It's just a very, very good, powerful engine. So what we're going to do is we're going to start at the front of the engine. We'll work our way back. So it all starts with the air intake, and up on the top of the cowl here we have the inlet barrier filter, and that's like an air filter that you have on your car. It's just to prevent sand and dust and debris and particles entering into the engine, because these are a very high speed, high precision engine and they don't like junk going in the front of them. So the barrier filter is the first line of defense. Once the air gets sucked through the filter, it comes down this funnel, which funnels the air into the front of the gas turbine engine. And the first part of the gas turbine engine is an axial compressor. And what that does is it compresses the air, so it increases its air pressure, and it increases the air's velocity going backwards. So first stage is the axial compressor, compresses the air, speeds it up. And then it goes into the second stage compressor, which is a centrifugal compressor. And what that does is it increases the pressure even further, but it also increases the temperature of the air. So now you've got the air that's gone through both compressor stages. It's highly compressed, its velocity is increased, and its temperature is increased. And it now then goes into the combustion chamber. The combustion chamber is basically where we get the big bang. So fuel is metered into the combustion chamber via the fuel control unit and two fuel nozzles. There's one on this side and there's one on the other side of the engine. Next to the fuel nozzles is two igniters, one on this side, one on the other side. So when I go to start the engine, I'm going to press the start button, and these igniters are just like the spark plugs on your car. They're going to start crackling. And then as the fuel and air mixture meet that spark, boom, we get the explosion, the engine begins to start. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep introducing fuel into the engine through the throttle until the engine's up to about 45% of its operating speed. At that point I can release the starter and the engine is self-sustaining. So the fuel entering into the combustion chamber keeps the fireball in effect constantly going. So the engine will keep running until I pull back on the throttle once I've landed and bring the engine back to idle or shut it off. Once the fuel and air mixture is ignited, it rapidly expands, and the only way for that air or gas to go once it expands is backwards, because at the front we've got the compressors pulling air in, it can only go backwards. So what happens next is it goes into the gas generator turbines, and there's two of them on this engine. And as the air rushes over them, they're just like a windmill. They basically catch the air and it turns. And what they do is they are mechanically connected via a drive shaft to the compressor. So as more air, or as the air expands and goes out the back, drives those gas turbine wheels, drives the compressor. So the more fuel I put in, the more bang I get, the faster the air goes out the back, the faster the gas generator spins, the faster it turns the compressor to pull more air in. Because if we don't have the right air to fuel mixture, then the engine's not going to operate as efficient. So the gas generator drives the compressor. So that's generally how a normal gas turbine jet engine works. On a plane, the rest of the air going out the back, coupled with the air around it, like a Venturi, pushes the engine forward as the gases escape out the back. And with the engine going forward, the engines are connected to the plane goes forward. In a turboshaft engine like this one, we have a bit of a different setup. So after the gas generator turbines, we have a power turbine, and in this engine we just have one. And the power turbine is not connected mechanically to the rest of the engine. It's its own freewheeling turbine, and when it's up to 100% operating speed and 100% power, that freewheeling turbine's turning at around about 40,000 RPM. It's crazy. So as the gases go out, same thing, it's like a windmill effect, it drives that power turbine. That power turbine feeds into the reduction gearbox, which is just behind this cover, just here. That reduction gearbox drops the RPM down from that 40,000 to 6,000 RPM, and it drives the main drive shaft, which is inside this tube. The main drive shaft goes forward through the firewall into the main transmission, which is in here. And it also goes backwards along the top of the tail boom to drive the tail rotor. So we have 6,000 RPM and all the power coming down into this drive shaft to drive the two gearboxes. So now the gas has gone out the back, that's pretty much how the actual engine itself works. The rest of the stuff that you can see on here is for oil and fuel, and gas turbine engines do not run very well without oil. There's some components in this turbine engine that's going to be operating around about 55,000-56,000 RPM when I'm at full power. So that's a phenomenal speed. And without oil to keep them lubricated and cooled, those things are just going to let go, bearings especially. So oil is very, very important. So these red lines here are basically oil lines coming in from the main oil reservoir, going off from the oil pump that's driven by the accessory gearbox here that's on the front. We have a small filter on here, and we have an engine driven oil pump. So anytime this engine is turning, it's pumping oil around the engine, because without oil, this thing is not going to last very long. If I get a drop in oil pressure, I'm starting to head to the ground. If I lose all oil pressure, I'm going to be shutting the engine down in flight and auto-rotating to the ground, because in here we have the freewheeling unit, and basically what that allows the aircraft to do is to keep the main rotor turning without the engine turning. And if that freewheeling unit doesn't have oil, it can seize within a matter of minutes. So if I lose all oil pressure, I'm straight to the ground with the engine off, because I need to keep whatever oil is left in the aircraft or in the engine around that freewheeling unit. So that's the oil. The next thing that we've got is this great huge thing here, and this is the fuel control unit. This is what controls how much power the engine produces, depending on my requirements from the cockpit. There's two mechanical linkages on here. The top one here is the throttle. So this is used when I'm starting the engine. So as I'm advancing that throttle forward, this is basically opening more fuel or metering more fuel into the engine. Once I've got the aircraft up to full flight RPM, the throttle doesn't move. It stays in one position for the entire flight. It's not like your car where you adjust the speed of your engine using the throttle. This one just stays at a set RPM, which for this A-Star, the main rotor RPM stays at around about 390 RPM, give or take a few. So that throttle stays open, stays exactly where it is until I've landed and I bring back the throttle to bring the engine back to idle. The lower one, however, is connected to my collective, and as I raise the collective, the linkage asks for more fuel. And the reason is, when I raise collective, what it does, it changes the pitch on all the rotor blades together. And as I change the pitch, they create more drag. So think of it like when you were a kiddie and you stuck your hand out the car window and it flew fine like this. The second you turned it, it got pulled backwards. And that is the drag that it creates. So to keep the rotor RPM at 390 RPM, as I increase the collective to gain more lift, I increase the drag that it creates, therefore it would start to slow the main rotor down. So what this linkage does is it puts more fuel into the engine to create more power to overcome that drag to keep the RPM of the main rotor at around about 390. So lift the collective, changes the pitch of the blades, and it also increases the fuel required into the engine, and it does it all automatically. And it's a really good system. I never have to really think about the RPM as it's going up and down. It follows really, really closely. It's very good. So that's the fuel control unit. The other cool thing that we have on this side of the engine are fire detectors. So we have flame detectors. We have one down here, one here, one up here, and one at the back here. And what they do is just a bimetallic strip that's stuck together. When they get too hot because there's flame in there, they open. They just expand just like a normal bimetallic strip does. And it then sends a signal to the cockpit where it gives me a engine fire warning light on my dashboard, which is really handy to know because I don't have rear view mirrors. I can't see out the back of this thing. So what I then do is I just start a turn, get into wind, look behind, see if I'm trailing smoke. And if that's the case, then I just follow the emergency procedures to deal with the engine fire. So the engine fire detectors are a nice addition to this aircraft. The rest of the pipes and wires and things on there are just fuel lines, oil lines, and air pressure lines that operate the engine. This is about as much as my knowledge on the engine. It's a very, very complex piece of equipment, very expensive piece of equipment, and it took some serious engineering, but that domain is the engineers. I'm just a taxi driver, so you've got about as much knowledge on it now as I do. So now let's go and have a look on the other side of the engine and show you what's different over there. So this is the right hand side of the Arriel engine, and not too much different on this side. There's just a couple of things that's a little bit extra that we don't have on the other side. The two most obvious ones are the two black boxes here and the black box here. These two black boxes are the starter, igniter, exciter boxes, and what they do is they take the 24 volts from the aircraft battery and really increase the voltage to a very high voltage for the spark igniters. There's two of them, one for each spark igniter, so when I hit that start button is basically firing the starter motor, and it's also firing the spark igniters up until that 45% until the engine is self-sustaining. So yeah, two boxes, it's one for each igniter. Second thing here is the starter generator, and it's a dual device. It's a starter and it's a generator, hence the name starter generator. So when I hit the starter button, just like a normal starter motor, when you turn your key in your car, it starts turning the engine over through the accessory gearbox. So once I release that starter button, the starter motor then stops, and it stops driving the engine, and the engine then drives that starter motor. It then turns into becoming a generator, and it generates electricity, which then feeds into the aircraft to drive my avionics, my instrumentation, my radios, my lights, my fuel boost pumps, you name it. Because if I didn't have the generator providing power, everything would be running off the battery. And as batteries do, they can only go so long before they run out of charge, and then I would have no electrical system in my aircraft. So I won't be able to talk to anybody, I won't be able to see what's going on with my instrumentation, things like that. So the starter generator is a very, very welcomed piece of equipment on this engine. We just have the lines, the cables from here going down into the avionics, which is under the floor of the cargo bay at the back here. The other things you can see, these red wires here, these are part of the TANIS heating system. And what that is on all the gearboxes and on the engine and on the oil and hydraulic reservoirs are electric heating blankets, and they're pads that are glued to all those places. And that's for when I'm operating the aircraft in cold temperatures. So in winter, when I need to go for a fly and it's like minus 20, minus 25, and the aircraft is out overnight, I can plug the aircraft into the hangar, and these just keep the oil warm. Because remember how I said earlier on, this engine doesn't do well with no oil, and if the oil is cold, there's going to be a couple of seconds, or you know, 10, 20, 30 seconds when this engine doesn't have very much oil going around it, and that's enough that it can cause damage to the components of the aircraft. So the TANIS heating system keeps the oil nice and warm, keeps it fluid so that it can be easily passed around the engine when I go to start that thing up at minus 25 in the morning. And yeah, it's cold, you don't want to be flying when it's minus 25, but that's the job, that's what we have to do sometimes. So on this side of the engine, the other two things that we have is right here and right here, and those are magnetic chip detectors. And what they do is they sit in the bottom of the two gearboxes where the oil pools, and they are magnetic. So if there's any pieces of metal floating around in the oil, the piece of metal will be attracted to the magnets on those plugs and will stick to them. So at the end of the day, when I finish flying, I take the magnetic chip plugs out and I look to see if there's any traces of metal on there. If there is, I can call the engineer, get them to come and have a look to see if it's within tolerance. If the particles are too big, it could be that the engine is producing metal and we need to remove the engine and have it sent away for inspection. So nice easy way for me to inspect to see if the engine is running as it should. And that's it, folks. That is the Arriel 1D1 engine on the B2 Astar. So I hope you found this interesting. I'm a tech guy, I love this kind of stuff, so I figured you would too. If you did, this is your first time here, hit that subscribe button. I have videos like this coming out all the time of all kinds of cool stuff on the helicopters that I fly, or helicopters that I see, or fixed wings, you name it, anything aviation. I'm just a full aviation nut. If you do hit that subscribe button, make sure you hit the notification bell as well, and then you'll be notified of when my latest video comes out. If you liked it, hit that thumb button, gives me a thumbs up, really helps the channel. I really, really appreciate it. If you have any questions about the engine, stick them in the comments below. Yeah, I'll get them answered. If it's worthy of a good video, then I can get the camera out and we'll get the cowls open again and show you even more detailed stuff. I hope you found this interesting. If you did, check out my other videos I've got here. I hope you'll like those too. And if you do, I'll see you on the next one.